There's a very mistaken impression from a lot of conservatives that the New York Times is somehow a liberal outlet, which is absolutely not the case. The New York Times has a long-standing history of ruthless corporate preferentialism. They just anything, self-interests, whatever narrative they can push. And I think one of the best ways to make that clear is by looking at the recent behavior of the New York Times with regards to trans people. So take a look at this, because we got a lot to go over. There was an opinion article recently put out called "The Relentless Attack on Trans People is an Attack on All of Us," which was shortly thereafter edited into "There is no dignity in this kind of America." For some reason, a pro-trans piece had its name altered so the title no longer referenced trans people. Vosh, usually the New York Times is more liberal than the most blatantly conservative outlets, though. No. Here's the thing. The reasons why conservatives don't like the New York Times is because they feel obliged to occasionally report factual reality, which is anathema to the modern conservative movement. If you report things that are truthful, you can never truly be loved by conservatives. The only way the conservative intelligentsia are capable of maintaining their viewership now is through the nonstop promotion of lies, with no exception and no break. That's how Fox does it. That's how the Daily Wire does it. It's how Newsmax and OANN did it, to an extent still do it. You just can't report on the truth at any point. The New York Times occasionally does, which means that it is off the road for a lot of conservatives, but that does not make them a left-leaning outlet. There was recently a letter delivered by GLAAD, an advocacy group, which criticized coverage of trans people in the New York Times. Many New York Times writers signed on to this letter. So the New York Times is being accused here of poorly addressing trans issues. And this accusation is being fielded not only by an advocacy group, but by many people who write for the New York Times. Listen to this letter, which was written by the New York Times itself. This is a response. "Colleagues, yesterday the New York Times received a letter delivered by GLAAD, an advocacy group, criticizing coverage in the Times of transgender issues. It is not unusual for outside groups to critique our coverage or rally supporters to seek to influence our journalism. In this case, however, members of our staff and contributors to the Times joined the effort. Their protest letter included direct attacks on several of our colleagues, singling them out by name. Participation in such a campaign is against the letter and spirit of our ethics policy. That policy prohibits our journalists from aligning themselves with advocacy groups and joining protest actions on matters of public policy. We also have a clear policy prohibiting Times journalists from attacking one another's journalism publicly or signaling their support for such attacks. Our coverage of trans issues, including the specific pieces singled out for the attack, is important, deeply reported, and sensitively written. The journalists who produce these stories nonetheless have endured months of attacks, harassment, and threats. The letter also ignores the Times' strong commitment to covering all aspects of trans issues, including the life experience of trans people and the prejudice and violence shown against them in our society. A full list of our coverage can be viewed here, and any review shows the allegations this group are making are demonstrably false." Essentially, the Times threatened the livelihood, saying that this is a violation of their ethics policy, of New York Times writers who signed on to a criticism of the Times for their poor coverage of trans issues. Essentially, you're not allowed to criticize us. Correct. One of the all-time favorite New York Times headline edits. Ah, yes, this was a good one. "Why strike at largest U.S. wholesale produce market? Workers are on strike. They want $1 an hour raise. Threaten supply chain." Yeah. "Why market workers are on strike? They want a $1 an hour raise. Strike at largest U.S. wholesale produce. Threaten supply chain." The New York Times does this constantly. They are a ridiculously pro-establishment institution. They are shameless. They are disgusting. They are demonic. So, immediately after being criticized for their poor coverage of trans issues, and it is poor, we get the one, the only, in defense of J.K. Rowling, literally the day after, by the way, from Pamela Paul, who, as I just noted, last opinion piece was "What Liberals Can Learn from Ron DeSantis." hip hip hooray, cheering news for free speech on campus. In other words, conservative fear mongering over campuses censoring, you know, conservative speakers and the like. Let's give it a look. It's not that long. Trans people need and deserve protection. I believe the majority of trans-identified people not only pose zero threat to others, but are vulnerable. I respect every trans person's right to live any way that feels authentic and comfortable to them. I feel nothing but empathy and solidarity with trans women who've been abused by men. These statements were written by J.K. Rowling, the author of the Harry Potter series, a human rights activist, and according to a noisy fringe of the internet, a number of powerful transgender rights activists. Yes. In defense of poor old J.K. Rowling, one of the wealthiest humans to ever live, and an incredibly powerful a single advocacy force, up against the powerful transgender rights activists and LGBTQ lobbying groups, a transphobe. I like how we're opening with a series of out-of-context statements that literally every bigot makes to cover their ass. I mean, if you wanted to, you could literally go through Nick Fuentes' live streams, and you could find him saying stuff like, "I'm not racist. I don't think that black people are worse than white people," big grin at the camera. "I don't have a problem with Jewish people." Like, you could literally find anyone. You could go to, like, David Duke. You could go to a Klan member, and if you, like pestered them enough, like, "Hey, people are saying you're bigoted." "I'm not bigoted. I just believe in the right to free association." Like, literally, the idea of, like, cobbling together the PR statements. You could probably find Hitler doing literally this. You literally can! That's not a joke! These statements were written by J.K. Rowling, the author of the Harry Potter series, a human rights activist, and according to a noise... Right, okay. Even many of Rowling's devoted fans have made this accusation. Yes. In 2020, the Leaky Cauldron, one of the biggest Harry Potter fan sites, claimed Rowling had endorsed harmful and disproven beliefs about what it means to be a trans person, letting members know it would avoid featuring quotes from and photos of the author. Yeah, a ton of Harry Potter fan groups have completely disassociated from her. The, like, main cast of the Harry Potter series did not even invite her to the movie meetup that they did. It wasn't just the Leaky Cauldron. Wasn't one of the main Harry Potter sites? Not just this one. There was another one that, like, completely disassociated from her, right? Wasn't there another one? Pottermore? Was it that? Oh, yeah, the Quidditch Sports League as well. The Quidditch Sports League, the nerds, the people who are so insanely pro... Pottermore is under her control. Was it MuggleNet? There was another one. I don't remember the details. But the people who were so nerdy that they played Quidditch IRL somehow... changed the name so that they wouldn't be associated with Harry Potter anymore. They renamed the sport. Other critics have advocated that bookstores pull her books from the shelves, and some bookstores have done so. She has also been subject to verbal abuse, doxing, and threats of sexual or other physical violence, including death threats. So I'm going to break down why this article is bullshit, just in case there's anyone who you know who likes this article and you want ammunition against them. You know, you want to be able to point at something. So here's the thing, okay? Literally every public activist for any cause receives these. These so-called powerful transgender rights activists get far more abuse, doxing, and threats of sexual or physical violence than J.K. Rowling does, proportional to the size of their advocacy. Everyone gets this. The disproportionate emphasis of this on J.K. Rowling specifically is part of an effort to frame her as somehow a victim here. The whole point is to frame her as some kind of, like, beleaguered, victim of public outcry and cancellation, when in reality she is unimaginably powerful, and the stuff that she said has been directly cited as justification for a number of laws that have been passed to harm trans people. J.K. Rowling is literally, like, the number one anti-trans advocate and is frequently cited by people who then go on into British Parliament to argue on ongoing trans issues. There is no comparison to be made here. Now, in rare and wide... Vladimir Putin cited her as a warrior against Western degeneracy, saying that the cancellation that she had experienced was similar to the cancellation Russia has experienced because she's fighting against an element of Western degeneracy, as is he. Like, literally, Adolf Hitler rising from the grave to give J.K. Rowling two thumbs up, you know? Now, in rare and wide-ranging interviews for the podcast series, The Witch Trials of J.K. Rowling, which begins next week, again, trying to compare J.K. Rowling to the witches, the so-called witches of the Salem Witch Trials, which is ridiculous because the attacks that were made against alleged witches were components of religious misogyny, whereas what's happening right now is a reinforcement of institutional bigotry coming from J.K. Rowling. The witch trials in this case are being done to trans women. Completely baseless accusations being made against them for no reason other than the institutionalized bigotry of the people who are crusading against them. Rowling is sharing her experiences. I've had direct threats of violence. I've had people coming to my house where my kids live. First of all, again, all online activists have had direct threats of violence. All celebrities have had direct threats of violence against them. For two, your address is a publicity stunt. There have been news articles on the castle that J.K. Rowling lives in. It's literally featured in, like, celebrity tours. People go there as part of, like, visiting the famous castle. It's like Hollywood tours in Los Angeles. Coming to the house where your kids live, you invited that. It's a celebrity house. I've had my address posted online. Oh, no, not your address at the place with its own Wikipedia article. Oh, I can't believe Wikipedia doxed you. Oh my God. The Kilichase estate has existed for centuries. It's literally a castle. Well, it's not really a castle. It's a manor. That'd be the term, right? It's a manor. In the 17th century, the estate was owned by members of Clan Murray, who began blah, 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 purchased by J.K. Rowling. Right. J.K. Rowling is literally befriended with Caroline Farrow, who doxes trans people on Kiwi Farms. Yes, J.K. Rowling is both beloved by and friends with multiple people who actively participate in doxing people who don't have publicly listed addresses that they celebrated and made, like, PR pieces of. That's not her only house, by the way. There are plenty of other ones that are, like, famous for being her house. She's a billionaire. Billionaires tend to have public houses. Anyway, I've had what the police anyway would regard as credible threats. This campaign against Rowling is as dangerous as it is absurd. The brutal stabbing of Salman Rushdie last summer is a forceful reminder of what can happen when writers are demonized. Ah, a perfectly fair comparison here. So, if I recall correctly, this person was stabbed because of some long-standing, like, Islamophobia stuff. It was like he criticized Islam and was like, there were like, no, that was a different person. What were the details here? Oh my God, this person has an incredibly long Wikipedia. Al-Qaeda hit list? Oh, I am correct. I was correct. I'm always correct. Rushdie had a fatwa issued against him. Okay. So I would say there's a pretty big difference between being put on the Al-Qaeda hit list and being attacked for being the head of an entire hate movement. In Rowling's case, the characterization of her as a transphobe doesn't square with her actual views. So why would anyone accuse her of transphobia? Surely Rowling must have played some part, you might think. The answer is straightforward. Because she has asserted the right to spaces for biological women only, such as domestic abuse shelters and sex-segregated prisons. Right. So, I want to be clear. The fact that this is being published, even as an opinion piece, is journalistic malpractice from Twitter. From the New York Times. It is journalistic malpractice. This is such an objectively falsifiable and false statement that to make it should absolutely qualify as, like, publishing with malintent incorrect information. J.K. Rowling has literally befriended the far right, literally said things positive of a number of far right characters as long as they were transphobic, going so far as to agree with things that Matt Walsh has said and done. In essentially every anti-trans culture war point possible, she has made friends with people who want to keep trans women out of women's restrooms. She has made friends with people who openly want to remove trans people from society. The TERF movement is full of people who talk about the need to remove trans people, to just, like, in an ideal world, they simply would not exist, which is unabashed genocidal rhetoric. J.K. Rowling has repeatedly framed trans women as predators, as violent, as threatening, because you can't actually assert the need for biological women's spaces only without referring to some imaginary and completely unsubstantiated idea that trans women are somehow more dangerous. She calls trans women duplicitous rapists all the time because that is the narrative behind keeping them out of domestic abuse shelters and sex-segregated prisons. If you want trans women to be thrown into male prisons or kept out of domestic abuse shelters, that is a pro-position. We have factual information that trans women are far more likely to be abused by men in men's prisons or in any kind of, like, sex-segregated, closed-off area. But we have no evidence that trans women contribute to harm when they're in women's prisons or when they're in women's domestic abuse shelters. There is absolutely nothing to this besides empty bigotry. And she has fully endorsed the worst versions of the, like, far-right anti-transgender agenda. There's no moderation here. Because she has insisted that when it comes to determining a person's legal gender status, self-declared gender identity is insufficient. This reminds me of people who were playing defense for Richard Spencer back in 2016. The idea of, like, he's not a white supremacist. He's a white nationalist. See, he doesn't think that black and white people are worse or better than each other. He just believes in blah 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 blah. You know, it's the exact same, like, grit your teeth and tell lies, everyone knows bullshit that has gotten less common with race issues in some respects, but now evidently far more common with trans issues. Vosh, the writers for the New York Times just put out a statement about how the lead editor is anti-LGBT, even linking how they helped cover up the AIDS epidemic. Ooh, from NewYorkTimeLetter.com. We're disappointed that the New York Times chose to use their public response to Wednesday's coalition letter from GLAAD and other organizations as an opportunity to attempt to dismiss the well-documented complaint of editorial bias detailed in our letter. Times representatives avoided addressing the substantive concerns in the letter by simply alleging that it came to them through GLAAD. However, GLAAD confirmed to us they did not deliver a copy of our letter to the New York Times. We look forward to clarification from the Times. This goes on for quite a while. Dear Philip, we write to you as a collective of New York Times contributors with serious concerns about editorial bias in the newspaper's reporting on trans, non-binary, and gender non-conforming people. Plenty of reporters at the Times cover trans issues fairly. Their work is eclipsed, however, by what one journalist has calculated as over 15,000 words of front-page Times coverage debating the priority of medical care for trans children published in the last 8 months alone. The newspaper's editorial guidelines demand that reporters, quote, preserve a professional detachment free of any whiff of bias, end quote, when cultivating their sources, maintaining, quote, remaining sensitive that personal relationships with news sources can erode into favoritism in fact or appearance, end quote. Yet the Times has in recent years treated gender diversity with an eerily familiar mix of pseudoscience and euphemistic charged language. Hey, does that sound familiar? While publishing reporting on trans children that omits relevant information about its sources. For example, Emily Bazelon's article, The Battle Over Gender Therapy, uncritically used the term patient zero to refer to a trans child seeking gender-affirming care, a phrase that vilifies transness as a disease to be feared. Bazelon quoted multiple expert sources who have since expressed regret over their work's misinterpretation. Another source, Grace Lidinsky-Smith, was identified as an individual person speaking about a personal choice to detransition rather than the president of GCCAN, an activist org that pushes junk science and partners with explicitly anti-trans hate groups. In a similar case, Katie Baker's recent feature, When Students Change Gender Identity and Parents Don't Know, misframed the battle over children's right to safely transition. The piece fails to make clear that court cases brought by parents who want schools to out their trans children are part of a legal strategy pursued by anti-trans hate groups. These groups have identified trans people as an existential threat to society and seek to replace the American public education system with Christian homeschooling, key context Baker did not provide to Times readers. This goes on for quite a while. Oh, hold on. Wait, I want to read this specific paragraph. New York Times managing editor and executive editor A.M. Rosenthal neglected to put AIDS on the front page until 1983, by which time the virus had already killed 500 New Yorkers. He withheld planned promotions from colleagues he learned on the grapevine were gay. Many of his employees feared being outed. William F. Buckley published his op-ed arguing that people with HIV/AIDS should all be forcibly tattooed in the Times. Obituaries in the Times ascribe death from HIV/AIDS to undisclosed causes or a rare disorder that left the partners of the deceased out entirely from its record of their lives. This era of hateful rhetoric also saw the rise of the term patient zero, used to falsely accuse HIV/AIDS patients of deliberately infecting others. This is the same rhetoric that transphobic policymakers recently reintroduced in to the American lawmaking apparatus by quoting Emily Bazelon's Times articles. So the allegedly left-leaning New York Times still has its executive editor, the same guy who was covering up the HIV/AIDS epidemic and allowing articles to be published that essentially treated, that literally like tattooing it. Like, yeah, no, that's Nazi Germany shit. Full on like genocidal language. And the same language is now being repurposed 40 years later. The exact same rhetoric, the exact same logic being repurposed today. Oh, look at the paragraph right above. They do the drag thing, drag queen thing too. Wait, no, this guy isn't the editor. He's dead now. Oh, this guy's currently dead. Wait, a managing executive editor neglected to put until 1983. When did he die? Oh, 2006. Okay. So they're identifying the same trends that are being made evident. Gotcha. Yeah, 2006. In 1963, New York Times published a front page story with the title Growth of Overt Homosexuality in City Provokes Wide Concern, which stated that homosexuals saw their own sexuality as an inborn, incurable disease, one that scientists the Times announced now thought could be cured. The word gay started making its way into the paper. Then in 1975, the Times published an article by Clifford Jarre about a queer cruise featuring a sadomasochistic fashion show. Damn, it really is the same rhetoric, isn't it? The whole idea of like patient one, social deviancy, the obsession with the fixation with promoting it as some kind of like degenerate sexual interest as opposed to it just being like how people are. It's the exact same thing over and over and over again. Oh, a lot of people signed on to this. And time truly is a flat circle. A lot of people supported this. Like a lot of people. Hundreds of LGBT organizations have signed on and denounced the New York Times. Yeah, the people up at the top of the New York Times are fully complicit in this hate movement. By allowing dreck like this to be published, the fact that it's an opinion piece is of no relevance whatsoever. They looked over this, they published it. Opinion pieces are still published by the New York Times. It's not like a social media feed where you get to just post whatever you're thinking. It still gets vetted and looked over. You can't publish anything. Because she has expressed skepticism about phrases like people who menstruate in reference to biological women, who the f*** cares? Because she has defended herself and, far more important, supported others, including detransitioner and feminist scholars who have come under attack from trans activists. This is the exact... Guys, this obsession with they're just being skeptical, they're just asking questions, this is the exact same shit we hear from Nazis. Right? We heard all of this from the alt-right rise on YouTube. Oh, they're not promoting a white ethnostate. They're just asking questions. They're being labeled, branded by the mainstream media as a Nazi only because they're skeptical of modern immigration trends. Like, I remember all this shit with Lauren Southern. It's exactly the same. There's no actual willingness to engage in these topics because they know that a full-faced defense of what J.K. Rowling has said and done, the people she's befriended. If you're interested, by the way, in a full rundown of the far-right assholes that J.K. Rowling has made bed pals with, I strongly suggest the Sean video on the subject, J.K. Rowling's New Friends.
Hello.
It's literally just a litany, just a long, long list of like ultra far right people who are not exclusively transphobic, but are also openly fascistic. Some of them are like basically neo-Nazis, but it doesn't stop J.K. Rowling from allying with them. And because she followed on Twitter and praised some of the work of Magdalene Burns, a lesbian feminist who has made incendiary comments about trans people. So the incendiary comments that we're talking about here are genocidal rhetoric. Magdalene Burns was a piece of shit who was gifted to all of us by God a brain tumor, which thankfully ended her miserable life. She spent that life screaming on YouTube about how trans women are degenerate, about how they're subhuman, about how they're a threat to all women. She called them freaks. She was an absolute piece of shit. She was unabashedly hateful. There was nothing even remotely feminist about her critique. It was purely and entirely just hate spit out from her lips. No justification, no systemic analysis. You might disagree, perhaps strongly, with Rowling's views and actions here. You may believe the prevalence of violence against trans people means that airing any views contrary to those of vocal trans activists. What views? Exactly, out of curiosity. I noticed that the only summaries of J.K. Rowling's positions we're getting here are people only dislike her because she's skeptical of this, that, the other. Not any actual engagement with the stuff that she's said or the position she's defended. Probably because they're pretty indefensible. It's really, really, really difficult to do so when you're clear about them. I mean, you can just scroll through Rowling's Twitter feed, can't you? I don't know about you, but excluding women from women's prisons just because they've got penises, male pattern baldness, and have committed a couple of rapes seems awfully turfy to me. So I have no idea what point is trying to be made here other than like, ew, trans women, keep them away. But we do know for a fact that trans women are going to be subject to an enormous amount of sexual violence in men's prisons, and we have no evidence that they'll be that they will subject others to sexual violence in women's prisons. There's literally no evidence to that fact. So the fact that they're still going over it, look, that's the entire thing. Oh, remember this one? Female ex-prisoner in Scotland describes the daily reality of being forced to share shower areas and cells with trans women convicted of domestic abuse and murder. This is the very definition of cruel and degrading punishment. And then we looked at the article, and it was literally just, they would be in the changing room together. This person doesn't describe any harassment. They don't describe anything happened. Not even a cruel word. Literally just, she was in a changing room, and then one of the trans women, like, took a shower around her, and she saw their penis. And that was it. That was it. Now, if you are a so-called reasonable critic of some trans ideology, why would you be making arguments like this, meaningless arguments, if your real position was not simply that trans women are degenerates who need to be excluded from society? The more people make bad arguments which just happen to coincide with genocidal rhetoric, the more it becomes clear that the genocidal rhetoric is the actual intended purpose of what they're saying, and not just an incidental side thing. Ah, yes, same shit, different century. What I would do with suffragists and this image. Phenomenal stuff right here. Truly a serious advocate for women's rights. Any evidence that trans women hurt cis women in shared spaces? None at all, despite years of this being talked about? No, that's okay. I'm sure it exists despite its apparent absence. Delighted to announce that after a surprise visit to the real world, where she reluctantly admitted a hulking great rapist doesn't become a woman by putting on a wig. Yeah, J.K. Rowling is just a sensible critic of gender ideology. There's no evidence at all of just seething hatred under the language she uses. It's a total coincidence that the language she uses just happens to overlap with the dehumanizing language that racists use for black people and anti-Semites use for Jews. But nothing Rowling has said qualifies as transphobic. Mm-hmm. She is not disputing the existence of gender dysphoria. No, she just says that it's a mental illness that doesn't actually make you a woman or a man. She has never voiced opposition to allowing people to transition under evidence-based therapeutic and medical care. Evidence-based therapeutic and medical care is carrying a lot of weight here. And this is, for one, not true. She has openly agreed with and allied with American conservative pundits who are advocating for the complete federal ban on any kind of trans healthcare. She has absolutely allied with people who have argued against any kind of federal subsidy or Medicare benefits when it comes to necessary trans healthcare. And what's more, even if she's okay with people transitioning, if she then refers to them as delusional freaks, that doesn't make her any less transphobic. Like, this would be like arguing that a person isn't racist because she thinks that it should be legal for black and white people to live next to each other, but then goes on to refer to black people as disgusting freaks. It doesn't make you less racist. That just means that your involvement in the bigotry doesn't like run up against federal bans on some like adjacent issue. She is not denying trans people equal pay or housing. That's the line we're running at right now. She has not openly said trans people should be paid less or not be allowed to be housed. She has not literally advocated for like an apartheid system for trans people. Therefore, how could she possibly be transphobic? There's no evidence that she's putting trans people, quote, in danger, except for her insisting that trans women be forced into men's prisons, that being like the main thing that she's obsessed with. As has been claimed, nor is she denying their right to exist. Take it from one of her former critics, E.G. Rosetta, a journalist who once denounced Rowling for her supposed transphobia, was commissioned last year to write an article called 20 Transphobic J.K. Rowling Quotes We're Done With. After 12 weeks of reporting and reading, Rosetta wrote, "I have not found a single truly transphobic message." On Twitter, she declared, "You're burning the wrong witch." So one person doesn't disagree with her. That's it. Is J.K. Rowling transphobic? How I went from spreading this false narrative to seeing right through it. Ah, and who is this person exactly? E.J. Rosetta. This strikes to me as one of those. I used to be a liberal until I saw through the delusion, you know. And then you look into their history, and they absolutely were never a liberal. Oh, wow, crazy. Their pinned tweet is this article. 3 months ago, I was tasked with writing an article detailing 20 transphobic J.K. Rowling quotes we're done with. Well, it's actually quoted from this tweet. So the op-ed that we were looking at here literally just quotes her tweet, where she, interestingly, despite being a person with 16,000 followers and seemingly basically no engagement on her tweets, 57 likes 19 hours ago, 6 hours ago, 4 likes. This one has 70,000 likes. Interesting. I wonder if there's any ulterior financial motive or any astroturfing going on here. I'm extremely curious. Ah, here's her retweeting the In Defense of J.K. Rowling article right there. Crazy. Can you social blade her Twitter? Ooh, that's an interesting question. E.J. Rosetta, Social Blade, Twitter. Is her Twitter even large enough to show up on EJ Rosetta? What's her actual handle? Just EJ. Okay, so it's just the same. EJ Rosetta. Social Blade is really, really bad when it comes to finding smaller accounts. Damn, guys. As much as I'd love to hit you with some interesting data here, the God's honest truth is that nobody cares about this bitch. I'm really sorry. That's the truth of it. I wish I could tell you more. I wish I had more to tell you, but nobody cares. This hasn't even, like, this, like, astroturfing bullshit hasn't even, moved over onto being some kind of personal wealth, apart from whatever she was paid to do that. Top TRA fail was calling us TERFs. It united us. We bonded, which enlightened us. We're stronger. Now when a woman speaks, you can't con her. TERF's a slur no longer. TRA means trans right activist. Yeah, this person was definitely initially a critic of J.K. Rowling. Now she just has a podcast called Trans Rights Activist Top Fails. This is entirely authentic. Women going their own way. Phenomenal. Many words have trans in them. Transport. Translate. Transcribe, etc. But cis? Before recently, it was only used in one word before it was hailed as how to describe not trans people. A cistern. You know, that thing in a toilet. They're comparing biological women to toilets. Lovely. This person. This is the person whose credibility is being cited in this article that was published and therefore tacitly endorsed by the New York Times. This is what we're getting. This is the quality of journalism that we're looking at here. It's not even etymologically correct. No, it's not. It's a chemistry term. Trans means across from. Cis means not across from or on the same side of. It refers to molecular structure. If something is trans, that means it's not cis in the sense that if something is across from something, it is not next to something. It's organic chemistry. That's it. Cistern has a totally different etymology. For the record, I too read all of Rowling's books, including the crime novels written under the pen name Robert Galbraith. You know, Robert Galbraith, the name of the person who came up with gay conversion therapy, the name she just coincidentally chose as her pen name. That was weird. Really common name, Robert Galbraith, that she chose, and came up empty-handed. Those who have parsed her work for transgressions have objected to the fact that in one of her Galbraith novels she included a trans character, and that in another of those novels, a killer occasionally disguises himself by dressing as a woman. Needless to say, it takes a certain kind of person to see this as evidence of bigotry. Again, in this novel, the killer's, like, way of attacking women is to disguise themselves as a woman to lure the woman into a false sense of security and then to attack them. It is literally the narrative that J.K. Rowling falsely pushes to describe what trans women do. The idea of man dresses up as woman to prey on women, that is what J.K. Rowling thinks trans women are. So yes, a novel in which that person is doing that, despite it not being a thing that happens in real life, would be kind of, you know, indicative a little bit. This isn't the first time Rowling and her work have been condemned by ideologues. For years, books in the Harry Potter series were among the most banned in America. And interestingly, all of the people who wanted to ban the Harry Potter books now like J.K. Rowling. Many Christians denounced the book's positive depiction of witchcraft and magic. Some called Rowling a heretic. Megan Phelps Brokber, a former member of the Westboro Baptist Church and author of Unfollow, a memoir of loving and leaving extremism, says that she appreciated the novels as a child, but raised in a family notorious for its extremism and bigotry, she was taught to believe Rowling was going to hell over her support for gay rights. Yeah, her extremely authentic support for gay rights. Even though she is openly friends with a bunch of anti-LGBT hate movements. Phenomenal stuff. Phelps Roger has taken the time to rethink her biases. She is now the host of The Witch Trials of J.K. Rowling. Really? They got a former Westboro Baptist Church member presiding over a podcast meant to defend J.K. Rowling? That's seriously the person they got? The podcast, based on 9 hours of her interviews with Rowling, the first time Rowling has spoken at length about her advocacy, explores why Rowling has been subjected to such. Also, this isn't true. When Rowling first started being an open transphobe, she wrote like a big, what do you call it? Manifesto? Guys, I've seen the Contra tweet. Thank you for linking it 17 times. I appreciate that. Wow, Contra was a guest in that podcast. That's crazy information. I only could have known that if I'd scrolled up slightly and seen like 5 people linking it on the same page that you're on right now. Jesus. She wrote a manifesto where she basically said that the reason why she's transphobic is because she was sexually assaulted by a guy, which, you know, as excuses for being a bigot go, I don't care. Explores why Rowling has been subjected to such wide-ranging vitriol despite a body of work that embraces the virtues of being outsider, the power of empathy towards one's friends, and the primacy of loyalty towards one's friends. Or empathy towards one's enemies, the primacy of loyalty towards one's friends. Guys, she can't be a bigot. She wrote a story about the power of friendship. The podcast, which also includes interviews with critics of Rowling, delves into why Rowling has, apparently including Contra, has used her platform to challenge certain claims of so-called gender ideology, such as the idea that trans women should be treated as indistinguishable from biological women in virtually every legal and social context. Why not? Why, both her fans and her fiercest critics have asked, would she bother to take such a stand knowing the attacks would ensue? The pushback is often, you are wealthy, you can afford security, you haven't been silenced. All true, but I think that misses the point. The attempt to intimidate and silence me is meant to serve as a warning to other women with similar views who may also wish to speak out. Yes, that's true. If the similar views we're referring to are genocidal bigotry, then yes, the opposition is towards that ideology. Of course. Again, the whole point of this article is to frame J.K. Rowling as the victim when she is unimaginably powerful and she is friends with people who are literally politicians who are passing part of an unprecedented wave of hate legislation against trans people. Westminster shut down Scotland's gender identity bill using a power they've had for decades but have never actually used. During a time of increasing support for Scottish independence, Westminster exacerbated that feel of independence because they were so afraid of anything pro-trans coming out of Scottish Parliament. There are hundreds of anti-trans bills being fronted month to month in America right now, but somehow J.K. Rowling, the person who is openly friends with some of the most powerful transphobes in the world, and is herself probably the loudest transphobe in the world, she's meant to be the victim. And I say because I have often seen it used that way, Rowling continues. She said other women have told her they've been warned. Look at what happened to J.K. Rowling. Watch yourself. Yeah, look at what happened to J.K. Rowling. Nothing. Recently, for example, Joanna Cherry, a Scottish National Party lawmaker who is a lesbian and a feminist, publicly questioned Scotland's passage of a self-ID law that would allow people to legally establish by mere declaration that they are a woman after living for only 3 months as a trans woman and without any need for a gender dysphoria diagnosis. She reported she faced workplace bullying and death threats. Damn, a politician getting death threats, that's definitely something that never happens to pro-trans politicians. That never happens to anyone who's pro-trans. This it totally isn't just a ubiquitous component of political advocacy that is only being mentioned on their side as a way of disingenuously framing what is going on as some kind of like disproportionate or selective response. I think some people are scared to speak out in this debate because when you do speak out, you're often wrongfully branded as a transphobe or a bigot. The language on this is identical to the language of open racists. The line from people who are like David Duke, Klanner types, for decades now has been, most Americans agree with our racist beliefs. They're just too afraid to speak out because they'll be falsely branded as racist. It's not racist to love your own white people or whatever, they say, and most people agree with that. They're just afraid to say it because then they'll be branded by the Jewish media as being racist. This is like a long-standing position from bigots every time where if there is ever any blowback to their bigotry, play the victim, make it seem as though they're only engaging in some, you know, light skepticism of existing positions rather than the open frothing bigotry they actually are doing, and then act as though everyone kind of sort of agrees with them. It's just the, you know, the public shaming that's keeping them from openly expressing this. The silent majority backs their position. Rowling, Phelps Roper added, views speaking out as a responsibility and an obligation. She's looking around and realizing other people are self-censoring because they cannot afford to speak up. Yep. Also remember that the amount of money backing anti-trans legislation is literally orders of magnitude higher than the opposite. Anti-trans legislation is being backed by billionaires, the kind of people who fund Fox News and the Daily Wire, who will find any random transphobe who has a story to tell and give them a slot on Tucker Carlson. Like, if you like, remember all those stories of like, here's a dad who made a Twitter thread because he was mad that his local school acknowledged trans people when his kid was in class. And then this guy goes on Tucker Carlson. You remember that? There was also a lot of discourse on this with critical race theory. Anyone who had a story to tell, just have an appropriately outraged Twitter thread and you will be given a spot on the largest conservative pundit show in American history. There is an enormous amount of wealth here. The same is not the case for actual trans advocates. As Rowling herself notes in the podcast, she's written books where from the very first page, bullying and authoritarian behavior is held to be one of the worst of human ills. The Harry Potter books endorse slavery and are constantly making bullying jokes about fat people. Okay. Also, the idea of like, dude, I can't be a bigot. In my story, our trio of like skinny white people are shown to be the good guys even when other worse people bully them. Those who accuse Rowling of punching down against her critics ignore the fact that she's sticking up for those who have silenced themselves to avoid the job loss, public vilification, and threats to physical safety that other critics of recent gender orthodoxies have suffered. Note the language being used here, orthodoxy. We're invoking religious doctrine here when not a single argument has been made against any precept of trans ideology. And what's more, notice how the argument here is Rowling is sticking up for people who have silenced themselves to avoid consequences for being an open bigot. AKA, she's doing this for the benefit of an invisible group of people that she's assuming exist, but may not actually. We don't know, because by definition they have silenced themselves, and they are silencing themselves to avoid the social repercussions of being a bigot. Okay. Social media is then leveraged to amplify those attacks. It's a strategy Phelps Roper recognized from her days at Westboro. We leaned into whatever would get us the most attention, and that was often the most outrageous and aggressive versions of what we believed, she recalled. It may be a sign of the tide turning that, along with Phelps Roper, several like-minded creative people, though generally those with the protection of wealth or strong backing from their employers, are finally braving the heat. In recent months, and after silence or worse from some of the young actors whose careers Rowling's work helped advance, I love this framing. In recent months, and after silence or worse from some of the young actors whose careers Rowling's work helped advance, how dare the actors in the Harry Potter movies speak out against her when it was her work that gave them those jobs? I made you! Whee! Several actors from the Harry Potter films, such as Helena Bonham Carter and Ralph Fiennes, have publicly defended the author. Yeah, the older ones. Also, they are absolutely in the minority. I like how she didn't name all of the incredibly prominent actors who have condemned J.K. Rowling. Like, several young actors, but here are two specific people that I'm referring to, you know? In the works of Fiennes, J.K. Rowling has written these great books about empowerment, about young children finding themselves as human beings. It's about how you become a better, stronger, more morally centered human being. The verbal abuse directed at her is disgusting. It's appalling. So nothing here actually references any of the transphobia. This is literally like, she's a billionaire who gave me my who gave me like a career jump, you know? Hey, can I get some work, please? Like, none of this has anything to do with the actual social issue being discussed, despite media coverage that can be embarrassingly credulous when it comes to the charges against Rowling. How so? Access denied. Who did J.K. Rowling become, deciphering the most beloved, most reviled children's book author in history? By Molly Fisher. I wonder why they dislike this one. That E.J. Rosetta person seems pretty unstable and got denounced by TERFs after threatening to dox somebody's kids. Really? Oh, this person has me blocked. Excellent. Every trans advocate who commented on this told J.K. Rowling this story about being a trans ally who was commissioned to write about J.K.R. only to discover she wasn't transphobic was full of holes, yet the GC movement embraced E.J. Oh, it was made up from the get-go? Who could have guessed? Today they regretted that. Why? Today she threatened to post pictures of, quote, gender-critical leaders, Kelly J. Keene's kids, that she had taken at a KJK event. If KJK didn't give back her 500 quid lifetime membership she had accidentally paid to KJK's gender-critical organization. She also accused KJK's husband of looking at her breasts at the event and putting his arm around her to get a closer look at her breasts. EJ's evidence of this was a gif of him vaguely looking in the direction of her camera. EJ also felt the need to say she had good tits. Whoa! So it turns out this person is a f***ing psycho? KJK rallies literally citing Mein Kampf. Oh, is that? This was the Mein Kampf rally, was it? Oh, yes. This was the group with the rally that cited Mein Kampf. I remember that.
No, the big lie. The big lie was first described by Adolf Hitler in Mein Kampf. The big lie is such a big lie that ordinary people like us think, well, that can't be a lie, because I'd never tell any big a lie as that. We only lie in small ways. The big lie, well, there is one big lie going on, and it was begun by men in the early part of the 20th century. It was began when they had an erotic fantasy, and they just...
So, for those of you not in the know, she's essentially equating the idea of trans people existing to Adolf Hitler's Jewish question. The big lie, the idea that if you tell a person a lie big enough, they're more likely to buy it than a bunch of small ones, is generally used to refer to Adolf Hitler and Nazi Germany's policy of framing their development and their actions and their warring on the idea that Jewish people controlled every element of global society and were warring against Aryan people. So what she's essentially doing right now is being the Hitler. She is essentially like, it's beyond parody. Goebbels was the one who actually said the big lie, quote, not Hitler. Yeah, well.
Decided they were going to sell us the big lie. And what is the big lie? The big lie is trans women are.
So it was in an article. It was at a group rally associated with these people, possibly this very rally, where a person who made up a lie in order to get attention from J.K. Rowling was positively cited in an op-ed that the New York Times signed off on and tacitly endorsed. That is the level of credibility we're dealing with here. We are positively citing people who are so crazy they get denounced by the people who cite Hitlerite theory in favor of their anti-trans advocacy. In Britain, the liberal columnist Hedley Freeman left The Guardian after she said the publication refused to allow her to interview Rowling, based. She has since joined the Sunday Times, very credible, where her first column commended Rowling for her feminist positions. Really? What feminist positions were those, out of curiosity? When did feminism become a dirty word? The fourth wave that gave us Me Too has come crashing down amid sloganeering and rows over gender identity. Where do women go from here? Oh, right. Man, even an archive link? So by feminist positions here, we're talking about being anti-trans. Right. Another liberal columnist for The Guardian left for similar reasons. After decamping to The Telegraph, she defended Rowling despite earlier threats of rape against her and her children for her work. Yeah, that's really bad. It also happens to a ton of people who engage in any kind of public advocacy. I was betrayed and bullied for saying women should not be silenced. It's always the euphemism. It's always the euphemism. It's never just, it's never an actual expression of their positions. It's never just, I was speaking up for the rights of X or Y, you know? I wasn't promoting racism. I'm simply defending the right for white people to speak out about their experiences. Blah, 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 blah. Millions of Rowling's readers no doubt remain unaware of her demonization, but that doesn't mean, as with other outlandish claims, whether it's the big lie, oh, here's the big lie again, or QAnon, that the accusations aren't insidious or tenacious. So, what? Outlandish claims, whether it's the big lie or QAnon. So, I think this person is claiming that calling J.K. Rowling transphobic is comparable to the Jewish question or QAnon. Okay. The seed has been planted in the culture that young people should feel there's something wrong with liking Rowling's books, that her books are problematic, and appreciating her work is complicated. In recent weeks, an uproar ensued over a new Harry Potter video game. That is a terrible shame. Children would do well to read Harry Potter unreservedly and absorb its lessons. I think another thing that's really interesting here is that when people write articles like this, their obvious goal is to get in good with J.K. Rowling and to try to make a lot of money off of that grift. And you can tell because they're not just here to talk about the political side of things. They're here to suck J.K. Rowling off as hard as they can. It's never enough to simply address the political conflict, to take the positions and defend them. It has to be a full-throated defense of her as a person, even including the validity of her work, which has nothing to do with the actual takes on hand here. And that's usually because they're looking to get quote tweeted by her, or to get like a ton of attention, or to like get brought into the goodwill cycle of, yeah, I'm here with you. And it's just so transparent, you know? This Pamela Paul person doesn't seem to have a Twitter account. Oh, because it got banned. From libs of TikTok. Twitter just suspended columnist Pamela Paul's account after the leftist mob came after her for writing this piece about the erasure of women. Looking forward to seeing New York Times speak out about Twitter censorship. Tolerance for one group does not mean intolerance for another. Opinion. The far right and far left agree on one thing. Women don't count. Wow. Excellent. What a great feminist ally. The people who revoked Roe v. Wade and are currently arguing for women to be forced out of the workplace are the same as the left because the left thinks trans women are women. Excellent. What an ally to women's issues. What a warrior for feminism. Right. Least deranged lib. They're a conservative. The last article from this person was what liberals can learn from Ron DeSantis. The whole point of people like this is to front as a centrist so they can constantly both sides between the far right and the far left with an effort of pulling people on the left to the right. No effort is actually being made to pull people on the right to the left here. Wasn't she married to Bret Stephens? Was she? Well, look at that. First marriage to Times columnist Bret Stephens, which ended in divorce. Makes sense. Wonder why she was getting so much leeway with the articles that she was publishing. So this is the guy who got made fun of by Trump, right? This was the bedbug guy. Yeah, right of center opposition to Donald Trump. This was the guy who he's like one of the most aggressive Zionists out there. Controversy. Being called a bedbug. In August 2019, Stephen sent a complaint to a George Washington University professor and the university's provost about a tweet in which the professor called Stevens a bedbug because he's annoying, which he is. The topic of Stephen's next column was the rhetoric of infestation used by authoritarian regimes such as Nazi Germany. So this was like the unironic, like, Idpol crying, oh, they called me a bedbug, this is anti-Semitism. It wasn't. It's complete, because he's Jewish. It's completely made up, like, I'm going to pretend this is anti-Semitic. He got really mad about it. He was tweeting up a storm. The controversy went viral, leading to then-President Donald Trump tweeting, lightweight journalist Brett Stephens, a conservative who does anything that his bosses at the paper tell him to do, he's now quitting Twitter after being called a bedbug. Tough guy. It was also pointed out that in a 2013 Wall Street Journal article, Stephens had called Palestinians mosquitoes. Not an individual Palestinian, Palestinians as a people. Whereas he was just being called a bedbug for being annoying. This guy is like the definition of like neocon Zionist, thinks Palestinians are subhuman, piece of shit. And he was married to the woman who then went on to write this after defending Ron DeSantis and equating the far right and far left when it comes to being anti-women. You know, phenomenal stuff. I love going down these little rabbit holes because it really does reveal the rot at the core of these institutions. The New York Times is an incredibly, like institutionally reaffirmed force. It's an incredibly, like, well-structured power center. The idea that the people who are writing here are just like ordinary people expressing their opinions is complete bullshit. They're political operatives with specific agendas that act consistently in defense of those agendas. It's as simple as that. Yeah, sadly, she doesn't have a Twitter. I would love to see what her Twitter looked like before it got banned, because I guarantee you that her Twitter was not banned and then kept banned for an entire year just because she wrote an article that was transphobic. German high command for the Germans losing World War I. So when the woman is citing Hitler, she's essentially doing the same thing Hitler did. She's like Hitler, saying that a group, in Hitler's case, the Jews, and in hers, trans people, are perpetuating a big lie. Yeah, the big lie was referring to outgroups. You know, now in retrospect, we talk about Hitler's big lie, but like this was a propaganda strategy by Nazi Germany. Hey, Adam something. I hope you're able to inject some leftism into the sphere. All right, let's finish this article up. Because what Rowling says actually matters. In 2016, when accepting the Penn/Allen Foundation Award for Literary Service, Rowling referred to her support for feminism and for the rights of transgender people. As she put it, my critics are at liberty to claim I'm trying to convert children to Satanism, and I'm free to explain that what I'm doing is exploring human nature and morality, or to say you're an idiot, depending on which side of the bed I got out that day. What is that? What does this have to do with anything? In 2016 was before she even got started with it. What is it? What Rowling says matters. Years before she became an open transphobe, she said she likes disagreeing with critics. Okay. Rowling could have just stayed in bed. She could have taken refuge in her wealth and fandom. In her Harry Potter universe, heroes are marked by courage and compassion. Look at the this deep throating going on right now. This dick sucking. This is like, if you're unironically trying to defend against accusations of bigotry because she wrote children's books. Jesus Christ. Her best characters learn. This would be like arguing Walt Disney wasn't a bigot because he like created magical stories for children. Insane. I don't understand how they keep saying she supports the rights of trans people. Like, she by definition does not see trans women as equal to cis women. Yeah, it really depends on what rights, you know? Nick Fuentes, to my knowledge, has never like openly said that slavery should be reintroduced and unironically defended that position. So he would argue then, I support black people's rights, you know, open quote, to not be slaves, end quote. He probably has said that at some point. It's all just so openly dishonest. Her best characters learn to stand up to bullies and expose false accusations. And even when that seems like the world is set against you, you have to stand firm in your core beliefs and what's right. Defending those who have been scorned isn't easy, especially for young people. It's scary to stand up to bullies, as any Harry Potter reader knows. Gluck, gluck, gluck. Let the grown-ups in the room lead the way. If more people stood up for J.K. Rowling, they would not only be doing right by her, they'd also be standing up for human rights, specifically women's rights, gay rights, and yes, transgender rights. There you go. And then down here at the bottom from the Times itself, the Times is committing to publishing a diversity of letters to the editor. We'd like to hear what you have to what you think about this or any of our other articles. No doubt. This is, what do the comments say? Do we have an archive of that? So again, to summarize, J.K. Rowling is completely and unambiguously friends with people who want trans people dead. There is no two sides to this at all. No, sorry, no comment reading here. Did the article get deleted? No, we're just bypassing a paywall. So now we can finally take a look at this shit that you guys linked me 5 billion times, which is the Contra thing. Last year, I received an email from Megan Phelps Roper, an estranged daughter of the Westboro Baptist Church. She asked if I'd give an interview for a podcast on J.K. Rowling, the world's foremost champion of backlash to trans rights. I agree, this was a serious lapse in judgment. Here's what I was thinking at the time. Megan is a famous reformed bigot. She used to picket funerals holding a God hates sign. She told me she had personally interviewed JKR and had confronted her with talking points from my video. She'd spoken to JKR about me and thought it seemed only right to speak to me about JKR. This is what was pitched to me. I took the bait and consented to a pretty miserable 3-hour interrogation about my own transition, as well as the usual concerns about trans rights. At the end of the interview, Megan asked if I had any advice about the project. I said the one thing she definitely should not do is frame the conflict as a debate between two equally legitimate sides. Trans people versus transphobes, they both have some good points. It's now clear this is exactly what she's done, how she's conceptualized the project from the outset. Her stance seems to be that trans people and transphobes are equally dogmatic and combative, and if we could all just have a calm, civil conversation, empathy would prevail. She thinks this way because of her experience leaving the Westboro Baptist Church, aided by people on Twitter who kindly pushed back against her former hateful views. From this, she's extrapolated an entire political worldview. The basic problem facing humanity is too much polarization, or incivility. The aggrieved gaze, the mourning families of dead soldiers screaming back at her, you don't de-radicalize a bigot that way. Instead, the argument goes, we should approach bigots with love and compassion. There's a truth here about her rhetoric, but it's been disastrously misapplied. The fundamental problem is that Megan only understands bigotry from the bigot's point of view. Her experience with the Westboro Baptist Church has given her a heightened capacity to sympathize with bigots and a diminished capacity to reckon with the harm done to bigots' victims. She needs, above all else, to believe that bigots are misunderstood and redeemable. So instead of committing to anti-bigotry post-Westboro, she's retreated to a spineless skepticism with no moral convictions beyond wondering, who's the real bigot here? I guess we'll never know. This empty centrism cannot conceive of systemic power, of the legislative, institutional, and stochastic terror threats wielded against LGBT people. In assessing the trans debate, it has no standard but civility by which to judge the merits of both sides. Megan does not seem to grasp that trans people are fighting for our lives, our right to exist in society, and that this fight is in no way equivalent to the rationalizations offered up by people who oppose trans rights, even when the former are angry and the latter composed. She thinks God hates is wrong because it's rude, but if God merely had a few reasonable concerns about fags, well then we'd better do a whole podcast exploring the intricate nuances of her point of view. The podcast is titled The Witch Trials of J.K. Rowling, an obviously tendentious framing that presents JKR as the victim of an irrational hate mob. Though the podcast isn't out, I've decided to speak up now because there's a 99.9% chance this will help JKR and harm trans people. I don't want my involvement to lend any legitimacy to this. I regret my participation and would not have participated if I had fully understood the nature of the project. I feel I've been used and I share the sentiments of other trans people who are speaking out against it. I deeply sympathize with her here. There's really nothing to say besides the fact that the New York Times is complicit and an active participant in the hate mob against trans people. And what's more, always remember that what may sometimes seem like this totally organic group of anti-trans activists, you know, it may sometimes seem like people are just rising up to speak against trans ideology, but in reality, there's actually an incredibly cohesive network of money and connections behind the scenes. None of this is accidental. None of this is just random. We just read an op-ed that was ostensibly a defense of J.K. Rowling, who's supposed to be a progressive and an advocate for LGBT, feminist rights, whatever. And then somehow this defense is coming from a woman who was married to a conservative New York Times editor, is herself a conservative who constantly defends or at least equivocates between the far right and the far left. And in that defense, she's citing for legitimacy people who are so crazy that they get outed from Hitler citing anti-trans advocacy groups for threatening to dox the children of those members because they won't give her her money back. Like, we are talking about a level of crazy that runs down so far, but all of it ultimately is backed by money and shared clout chasing. It's disgusting, and they know what they're doing, and the people at the New York Times know what they're doing. Whew! I feel like we now know more than we ever need to about these subjects. Now read the Onion article. It is journalism's sacred duty to endanger the lives of as many trans people as possible. The task of reporting is not a simple one. Each and every day, reporters and editors at publications like The Onion make difficult decisions about which issues should receive attention, knowing that our coverage will influence not only how people think, but also how they act. This responsibility is at the core of an ongoing debate over whether news coverage of trans, non-binary, and gender non-conforming people is unduly biased. As the world's leading news publication with a daily readership of 4.3 trillion, The Onion is compelled to weigh in. We firmly believe it is journalism's sacred duty to endanger the lives of as many trans people as possible. And you all get the joke. I'm not reading the entire thing. Have you seen this? It's a follow-up to the original article. Oh, right. This. The follow-up. We didn't go over the follow-up. I forgot about the follow-up. J.K. Rowling and trans women, a furor. Readers have strong opinions on both sides about Pamela Paul's defense of the author. Let's see how it is. These are the opinion letters. Oh yeah, so these are like comments that wrote in. To the editor, this is a distressingly one-sided view of J.K. Rowling's comments. The outrage towards Rowling is justified. She's a wealthy, powerful author who's using her far-reaching platform to push the narrative about that trans women who exist in the farthest fringes of our societies pose a threat to her. This is the opposite of reality. Trans women are discriminated against daily and suffer abuse, aggression, assault, and even murder at the hands of cisgender people. They need support from the mainstream, not nuanced criticism. While this column does present a defense of J.K. Rowling, it does not paint an accurate picture of her comments. For example, it cherry-picks quotes describing her support for trans people that are comparable to Donald Trump saying, "I love Hispanics," after making repeated racist comments against them. It lists two actors from the Harry Potter movies who support her, but disregards the many actors from the franchise who condemned her stance. Miss Rowling's arguments may appear reasonable, but the allies she has made and stances she has taken are indefensible. Good. Based. True. To the editor. J.K. Rowling arguably did more to promote children's literacy than any other author in history, and that should be considered her greatest contribution to the world. Her views are not transphobic. They are pro-biological women who still don't enjoy full equality or representation or safety in any space. The lived experiences of trans... Notice, by the way, you will never see a study on actual harm being done to cis women from trans women. You will not see it. The lived experiences of trans women and bio women are not the same, even if our struggles are similar. Nobody says they're the same. I have never seen a trans advocate say that trans women and cis women experience the exact same lived experiences. Why would they say that? We are different. Bio women can be supportive of trans women and want spaces for bio women only, like sports competitions and domestic violence centers. No. Again, we're burying this under euphemisms here. For one, the use of the term bio women immediately suggests that trans women are not women. Trans and cis women are the terms. Women is a gender term. If you're saying biological women, you're referring to sex. To say bio women suggests that women is a biological sex-based term, and to do so is to state that trans women are not real women. The term separation here is fundamentally transphobic. That's why people say trans and cis women. Also, yes, turning away a trans woman from a domestic violence shelter and telling them the only place they can go is a male-oriented domestic violence shelter is absolutely not being supportive of trans women. Demanding equal access to every space when bio women don't yet fully have that. What does that mean? What What space do cis women not have? What are we talking about here? It's like jumping to the front of a very long line, then screaming at everyone who calls you out for it. Ah, so this is the exact same tactic that that person, that black person who said, say her name, was like appropriating a term from black people to use it for the murdered trans girl. This is the whole, yes, two minority groups are actually competing with one another for a finite, limited amount of social clout. And that actually, by advocating for the rights of trans women in this fashion, you're doing so in a way that detracts from cisgender women. Completely made up, by the way. Completely bullshit. Fake. But, you know, another letter. Pamela Paul continues to stoke a dangerous fire. Last year, she wrote another piece regarding the use of the word queer. Why the word gay is falling out of fashion. I pose the question to Miss Paul. Why must you continue to be the devil's advocate? Because she is a conservative who disingenuously fronts as a centrist and makes devil's advocate arguments as a way of actually defending conservatives? LGBTQ plus communities are under attack, especially young trans people, whose rights to essential health care are being threatened by legislation across the U.S. Now is not the time to be defending David Sedaris's questionable claims about the word queer or J.K. Rowling's comments that may or may not be transphobic. It doesn't necessarily matter what Ms. Rowling thinks about trans people or what Mr. Sedaris thinks of the word queer. What we need to hear are the voices of trans people. If we continue to amplify the voices of figures like Mr. Sedaris or Ms. Rowling over the people in our country who are actually under threat, then there is an extremely grim outlook for our future. And now we have another turf one, because we have to go back and forth. Because remember, this is the times. It doesn't matter who's right. As long as we give equal 50-50 representation to both sides, we are above criticism. As a lesbian feminist, I applaud Pamela Paul for having the courage to take on this highly controversial subject. Hey, quick question, by the way. Why did the Times say right here, readers have strong opinions on both sides about Pamela Paul's defense of the author? And when the both sides here are people defending Pamela Paul or attacking Pamela Paul, follow here with me for a second. Pamela Paul does this centrism bullshit, right? Hey, J.K. Rowling isn't actually transphobic. J.K. Rowling is actually an advocate for trans rights. J.K. Rowling is just advocating for bio women's rights as well. If that's the case, why aren't there conservatives attacking Pamela Paul's article? See, they frame it here like this is some kind of centrist take. Pamela Paul wrote an article that's right there in the middle, and people from both sides are attacking her. But they're not. There are people defending her and people attacking her. But there aren't really any conservatives attacking her, despite ostensibly her article containing a defense of the allegedly pro-LGBT J.K. Rowling. Isn't that kind of odd? Like, it's supposed to be a both sides framing, but for some reason, there's actually no conservative opposition to the narrative, which would kind of suggests that it's just a conservative narrative. I have followed the debate in my community and elsewhere. The lack of objectivity and ability to think critically about the issues raised by J.K. Rowling's position worry me. Many in my community have self-censored out of fear and made silence identical bigotry to every single racist. Every single time, man. Perhaps now the media grandstanding by a bunch of attention-seeking wannabe influencers in the LGBTQ communities can be parsed in a meaningful dialogue dealing with biological women's needs can be placed. Wow, great letter to include, New York Times. This doesn't even discuss the article. This doesn't even discuss it. All this does is say, hey, really glad that anti-trans stuff is being featured in the Times. Hopefully all of these homos will like shut up and let us be more transphobic in the future. This is literally just shut up trans people, thanks for the bigotry. There's nothing in here that actually refers to the content of the article. Jesus Christ. Like, all of the ones criticizing this article are like thoughtfully engaging with it and criticizing it, and the ones defending it are just shut up, trans people are bad, bio women are under attack, etc. Pamela Paul's column about the trans rights controversy surrounding J.K. Rowling got a lot of things right. Miss Paul covered relevant facts thoroughly and concisely. No, she didn't. But a critical detail was not explored. As Miss Paul's column says, Miss Rowling has asserted the right to spaces for biological women only, such as domestic abuse shelters and sex-segregated prisons. This stance effectively denies trans women any access to shelters for victims of domestic violence or to detention facilities that align with their presenting gender. Since almost no trans-only spaces exist, denying trans women access to already underfunded and scarce facilities that do exist leaves them in violent, life-threatening situations with no recourse. It is possible that Ms. Rowling, Ms. Paul, and others are unaware of just how dangerous it is for a transgender woman to be housed with male prisoners. No, they're fully aware. They're okay with it. They don't mind trans women being ganged by male prisoners. They don't mind. And guys, I fully guarantee that both in public and in private, TERFs gleefully talk about the mass rape of trans women in male prisons as the same way that conservatives gloat about criminals getting ganged in prison, like in male prisons, the same way that, like, as a presumed punishment for their identity. 100%, 100%, absolutely. No doubt about it. Or how devastating it is for a trans person to be refused shelter from a violent living situation. They don't care. Those with more privilege and access must always seek more understanding of those different from ourselves before advocating to deny those rights and access to necessary resources. The writer is the former director of the LGBTQA Center, now the PRISM Center at the University of Vermont. Okay? I'm so glad that someone is addressing this issue, and I want to thank both J.K. Rowling and Pamela Paul for their courage. Notice how every single message defending this article is also praising it for its courage. All of them are. Wow, it's so brave of this person to write in the New York Times to defend a billionaire. It's so brave of them to do this. The most important point for me was what the host of a podcast about Ms. Rowling said. A lot of people think Rowling is using her privilege to attack a vulnerable group, but she sees herself as standing up for the rights of a vulnerable group. Exact same thing that white nationalists believe. I agree. I have supported trans rights for ages. Doubt. I have an incredibly dear friend who underwent the surgery, whom I have supported and cheered on throughout her journey. But acknowledging a distinction can't or shouldn't be viewed as fearful, unfair, or hateful. What? Acknowledging a distinction? Nobody thinks trans women and cis women are the same. I have never seen a trans advocate say that. All these TERFs are like, we're just fighting back against the gender doctrine that trans women and bio women are exactly the same in every way, which is a position that all trans people hold. No! No one believes this. That's why the prefix is there. Yeah, it's always this dog shit paternalization. This, let me educate you. Are you aware of the fact that trans women and cis women are different? Oh, wow. That's crazy. Thanks for the info. Wow. That's amazing. It reminds me of all of the anti-gay marriage rhetoric, all like leading up to 2015, where conservatives were like, yeah, a marriage between a man and a woman is different between a marriage between a man and a man. And then somebody will be like, yeah, well, we support gay marriage. And they'll be like, you support gay marriage? But don't you know there isn't even a woman there? There's this like bad faith assumption that the other group isn't aware of what they're actually saying. It's unfortunate more people don't recognize that a woman born biologically female has been and still are a marginalized group in and of themselves. And once again, they're under assault. An assault they will never be able to quantify in any fashion. An assault that no data has been produced for. Nothing. Literally nothing. Absolutely nothing. No data. I have never heard it. I have seen so many TERFs scream and bitch and whine and moan on social media about how they're under assault, and I have failed to see time and time again anything. J.K. Rowling was signal boosting an article of a Scottish prisoner who was talking about the harrowing experience that she had peacefully sharing a shower in a prison with a trans woman. No damage done, no threats, no insinuations, just being there with a trans woman. Always worth remembering, by the way, that this was the exact same hysteria we saw from white women who didn't want to share any space with black women back after desegregation started kicking off, you know? It was always this, well, okay, you know, I'm not like against black women, but like we have different spaces and different needs. And there was a fear that black women were more masculine than white women, less dainty, less feminine, and that they would be violent in shared spaces. Did this happen? No. Yeah, they said this about lesbians too. They say this to this day about a lot of butch lesbians who still sometimes get precluded from certain spaces because they're accused of being men when they're just, you know, butch women. All of this is a testament to the fact that when TERFs claim they're speaking up for bio women, they are actually uniformly arguing against every kind of feminist progress that has been made since the 1960s. There are no TERFs that are feminists. They are mutually exclusive. No TERFs argue for feminism, because feminism must necessarily include a rejection of social standards that are being used right now to attack trans women. But they don't. They fully and uncritically adopt those social standards because it allows them to attack trans women. It reminds me of the LGB Alliance, you know, the group that was like, yeah, we're for lesbians, gays, and bis, not trans people. And then when it was looked at, like, where their money was spent, it was exclusively an anti-trans hate group and had nothing to do with promoting the rights or interests of LGB people. I remember. Every time, man. TERFs didn't give a shit when my reproductive rights were taken away. Yeah, remember when Roe v. Wade was the article leaked on Roe v. Wade was going to be overturned and J.K. Rowling didn't tweet about it for days? And then when she finally did, an actual legitimate attack against the sex-based rights of women, a real one, and she didn't tweet for days, she was dead silent. And then when she finally did tweet, it was this milquetoast, oh, people have criticized me for not speaking on this, you know, but okay, here we go, obviously I denounce this. And yeah, J.K. Rowling is friends with a ton of anti-choice activists because most of her friends are far right. Is there a point in today's stream that won't make me sad? I have at least one. What is this? Look at this little guy. Look at him wiggle. Wah. Yep. What are we doing? There we go. Why is he so wiggly? He's a little kitten. And he's wiggly. Ooh. Yeah? You can't escape me. Got him. Choke him out. Look at him. All right, be free. Wobbly little baby.